Thank y'all for that pre-service music. Very lovely. Good morning, Holy Cross.
Morning.
Welcome. Glad to have you here for worship this morning. Please make sure that you fill out our connection card. That way we know that we're here. It helps us to love you and take care of you and all of those things. And glad to have y'all as well. I would also invite you to pick up, we do have this month's newsletter with the calendar and everything else that's in the narthex. You can pick that out pick that up on your way out. If you have already picked it up, please don't read it during the sermon. So would ask you for that. Remember, we are meeting here during Lent on Wednesdays at 6 o'clock. So please come in for those worship services, and we've got things to teach you, and it's always good to get together as God's people whenever we have a chance to do so. So we would invite you on Wednesdays at 6 o'clock. Well, we have come here for worship this morning. Let's go ahead and stand, greet one another in whatever way you feel most comfortable, and then we'll sing.
Thank you.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. God established an everlasting covenant with Abraham.
But our faith has waxed and waned. O Lord, forgive our forgetfulness of your unchanging grace.
David wrote, "All the ends of the earth shall remember and turn to the Lord."
But we have failed to remind one another of God's mercy and love. O Lord, forgive our hesitancy to share the news of your gracious presence.
Paul wrote that because Christ died for the ungodly, we are justified by his blood.
But we have tried to hide our sinfulness, O Lord. Forgive our blindness to the necessary sacrifice of our Savior.
God sent his Son into the world with one purpose, to save us from the wrath of God. For if, while we were enemies, we were reconciled to God by the death of his Son, much more, now that we are reconciled, shall we be saved by his life. As a called and ordained servant of Christ, I therefore forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. Thanks be to God. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
And let us pray. Father God, you see that of ourselves we have no strength. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. And please be seated for the reading of Scripture.
The Old Testament reading for the second Sunday in Lent is from Genesis chapter 17. When Abram was 99 years old, the Lord appeared to Abram and said to him, "I am God Almighty. Walk before me and be blameless, that I may make my covenant between me and you and may multiply you greatly." Then Abram fell on his face, and God said to him, "Behold, my covenant is with you, and you shall be the father of a multitude of nations. No longer shall your name be called Abram, but your name shall be Abraham, for I have made you the father of a multitude of nations. I will make you exceedingly fruitful, and I will make you into nations, and kings shall come from you. And I will establish my covenant between me and you, and your offspring after you throughout their generations, for an everlasting covenant, to be God to you and to your offspring after you." And God said to Abraham, "As for Sarai, your wife, you shall not call her name Sarai, but Sarah shall be her name. I will bless her, and moreover, I will give you a son by her. I will bless her, and she shall become nations. Kings of peoples shall come from her." This is the word of the Lord. Our epistle is from Romans chapter 5. "Therefore, since we have been justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. Through him, we have also obtained access by faith into this grace in which we stand, and we rejoice in hope of the glory of God. More than that, we rejoice in our sufferings, knowing that suffering produces endurance, and endurance produces character, and character produces hope. And hope does not put us to shame, because God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit who has been given to us. For while we were still weak, at the right time, Christ died for the ungodly. For one will scarcely die for a righteous person, though perhaps for a good person one would dare even to die. But God shows his love for us in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Since, therefore, we have now been justified by his blood, much more shall we be saved by him from the wrath of God. For if while we were enemies, we were reconciled to God by the death of his Son, much more now that we are reconciled, shall we be saved by his life. More than that, we also rejoice in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have now received reconciliation." This is the word of the Lord.
And please stand for the reading of the gospel. The Holy Gospel according to St. Mark, the 8th chapter. "And Jesus went on with his disciples to the villages of Caesarea Philippi. And on the way, he asked his disciples, "Who do people say that I am?" And they told him, "John the Baptist, and others say Elijah, and others one of the prophets." And he asked them, "But who do you say that I am?" Peter answered him, "You are the Christ." And he strictly charged them to tell no one about him. And he began to teach them that the Son of Man must suffer many things and be rejected by the elders and the chief priests and the scribes and be killed, and after 3 days rise again. And he said this plainly. And Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him. But turning and seeing his disciples, he rebuked Peter and said, "Get behind me, Satan, for you are not setting your mind on the things of God, but on the things of man." And he called to him the crowd with his disciples and said to them, "If anyone would come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. For whoever would save his life will lose it, but whoever loses his life for my sake and the gospel's will save it. For what does it profit a man to gain the whole world and forfeit his life? For what can a man give in return for his life? For whoever is ashamed of me and of my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, of him will the Son of Man also be ashamed when he comes in the glory of his Father with the holy angels." And this is the gospel of the Lord. The congregation may be seated. I would invite the children forward for the children's sermon. You guys can come on down. Join me. All right. You can come on down to the middle. I'll sit in the middle here, and you guys can sit on the sides. You can sit in front of me. How's it going? I like your boots. Yeah, it's good stuff. Good boots game. All right, come on down. Good to see y'all. I got a question for you as we get together here. Does anybody here like to play games? Raise your hand if you like to play games. You do? Okay, so let me ask you, I'm asking about a specific kind of game. Does anybody here like to play board games? Do you like to play board games? Okay, who can tell me, you can put your hands down, who can tell me what's the name of a game that you like to play? You can raise your hands and tell me. What do you like to play?
Tag.
Tag? Okay, not quite a board game, but that's okay. What about you? Hide and seek, also not a board game. That's good. How about you?
Sorry.
You like to play sorry, right? Because then when you hit the thing, and everybody's like, sorry. Right. What do you like to play? Video games? Okay. I know a lot of people like to play those. My nephew likes to play video games. I think he plays too many video games. Just my opinion. Any other games you like to play? Anybody like to play like Candyland? Have you ever played that one? Yeah, a little bit? A little bit? Well, I need to tell you something. I love to play board games. It's like one of my favorite things, to get a group of people together and you play games together. Like, that is a lot of fun. I remember we used to do that when I was in college sometimes, and we would get together and play games. Here's, though, a really bad idea. Here's how you should not play games when you're in college. You should never play boys against girls. Yeah, it just ends up with everybody hating each other. It doesn't work well. In fact, I did bring one game with me. This is called the game of Harry Potter Hogwarts Battle, a two-player competitive deck-building game. Here's how much I like games. I like games so much that I haven't even played this game yet. Like, I bought it, but I haven't played it yet. So hopefully I'll get to play this soon. So as we think about games, I want to kind of contrast that with something. Here's what I read just a minute ago, because here's what Jesus said. Because for all of us, we need to know the difference between a game and real life, right? Because sometimes something is a game, and sometimes something is real life. Here's what Jesus says. "If anyone would come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me." So that's real life. That's not a game. And that is that if we are going to be with Jesus, we need to follow Jesus. And so what that means is we know that Jesus loves us. We know that Jesus gives us a lot of gifts, and he gives us every good thing that we have. And so we want to follow him, and we want to do what Jesus wants us to do in real life, not just in a game. You think you guys can follow Jesus? You think so? I think you can. Let's pray. Dear Jesus, help us to follow you. We love you, Jesus. And all God's people said, Amen. All right, that's my favorite part, guys. Thank you. So the kids are going to sing for us. So you guys are going to stick here and sing, and I'm going to get out of the way here, and then we'll sing a big person song. But you guys are singing for now.
So big, so strong, and so mighty, there's nothing my God cannot do. My God is so big, so strong, and so mighty, there's nothing my God cannot do. The mountains are his, the rivers are his, the stars are his handiwork too. My God is so big, so strong, and so mighty, there's nothing my God cannot do. Hey, here's another one. My God is so great, so strong, and so mighty, there's nothing my God cannot do.
That's right.
My God is so great, so strong, and so mighty, there's nothing my God cannot do.
Ha ha.
The mountains are his, the rivers are his, the stars are his handiwork too.
Thank you guys so much. We all can go back and sit with your families. Thank y'all for singing for us. And then as the children are making their way back, we'll sing our sermon hymn.
Thank you.
May the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O God, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. Glad to have everybody here with us this morning. I would like to as well extend a welcome to those who are watching at home, those who will watch at a later date. So we're glad to have you with us, worshiping in that virtual way. We will look today, one of our appointed readings for this morning is Genesis 17 here, and we will look at a man named Abraham. Now, we did last week look at Abraham at a later point in his life, but here we encounter in chapter 22 of Genesis. Today we're in Genesis 17, and so we will just dig in and we will walk through this. So Genesis 17, verse 1. When Abram was 99 years old, and so the first promise and first time that God spoke to Abram was in Genesis chapter 12 when he was 75 years old, and this is 24 years later. At the age of 75, God made the promise to Abram that he would have a son, and Abram has been waiting now for 24 years, and then God speaks to him again. And what is he going to say? It says, and God said to him, I am God Almighty, walk before me and be blameless. What does God mean when he tells Abram to be blameless? Does he mean without sin? And certainly that would be God's expectation. I think, though, more acutely, when he says blameless, it's not that he expects Abram to be perfect, but he wants him to be devoted wholeheartedly to the Lord. And that is certainly a calling that God places upon us, on all believers, on all who belong to him. He calls us to be devoted to him. It continues in verse 2. I will make my covenant between me and you and may multiply you greatly. And so this word covenant is very important as we read the story of the Bible, certainly in Abram's life, but in our lives as well. This concept of covenant and the definition that I would give you, what a covenant is a relationship with God on his terms. A relationship with God on his terms. So this is a very special word and a very special relationship that God calls Abram into. And Abram will get land and he will get lineage and he gets his Lord right here. And God said, all these things I am going to give to you. I'm going to bless you. I am going to change your life. And in doing that, you are going to walk with me. And it's this calling to Abram of just stick close to me. Stick close to your dad. And it's true for us as well, because God is so good to us, and he calls us to stay close to him. And this is how our relationship with God works over and over again. We see it, that God initiates and we respond. See, God initiates and we respond. So God calls Abraham, and then Abraham will respond to that. He initiates and we respond. Now, some people hear that and they say, Well, geez, it sounds like that's God being very controlling. Like, do we have any say in the matter? Why would God seek to kind of boss us around? Why is he so controlling in that way? And I would say this, God is controlling in the same way that parents of small children, God is controlling in the same way that you hold your kid's hand in the parking lot and tell them to walk with you, right? That God's people don't always need to understand everything. The one thing they do need to understand is that they need to stick with him. They need to stick with him. And how many tears have been shed by parents when all that needed to happen was their kids would stick with them and they didn't do it, see? That's the relationship that God calls us to here. Because God is good. God does know the future. And so it's not just a duty, it is a delight for us to walk with him. And so, right, that was the relationship that God had with Adam before sin entered into the equation. We read about Enoch in Genesis chapter 5, right, that God would go on walks with Adam in the garden, and that Enoch walked with God. See, this is this relationship that we would walk with him, and he would lead us forward. And he wants us to be blameless, not without sin, but instead that we would trust in him. Right? Job would describe it this way, that your heart's desire is to stop sinning. See? because sin that messes up and distorts our relationship with God. God is going to provide for you. So keep close to Him and turn away from sin and trust in Him. The story continues, verse 3. Then Abram fell on his face, and God says to him, Abram responds with worship. God says to him, Behold, my covenant is with you, and you shall be the father of a multitude of nations. No longer shall your name be called Abram, but your name shall be Abraham, for I have made you the father of a multitude of nations. And so he says, I am going to give you many nations. I am going to give you children. And this is a very important theme in the book of Genesis, and it is that children are always a blessing. And as God speaks to Abraham, he tells him, I will change your whole life. And it's such a big change that I'm going to change your name as well. You're not just Abram, you're Abraham. That means you're going to be the father of many nations. And as you think about it, as you look at the world in which we live, people talk about fearing change, but everybody wants to change, don't they? These are some of our most popular TV programs, right? We have Extreme House Makeover, and we have all those shows where they flip houses, and they take something that is not ideal, they take something that they think should be changed, and they do something with it to make it beautiful. We want to be different even if we don't know why, see? And so, here for Abram, right, he changes his name. And this happens in the Bible time and again. God changes a name. He changes a nickname, right? Simon is called Peter. Saul is then called Paul. And here, Abram is called Abraham. Exalted father is what it means originally. The name Abram means exalted father. Abraham, though, means father of many nations. This is what God promises to him. Verse 7. Where did it go? Well, I'll just keep going here. I will make you exceedingly fruitful, and I will make you into nations, and kings shall come from you. And I will establish my covenant, there's our word again, between me and you and your offspring after you throughout their generations for an everlasting covenant to be God to you and to your offspring after you. And God does everything that he says. He is good for his word. No one can thwart his plans, and says, in fact, this is going to be an everlasting covenant. It's as good as done. You will have it. And that is at the heart of covenant relationship, is this, that God gives himself to us. Every other religion, every other faith, belief system, however you want to characterize it, is about what you do for God. In opposition to that here, God says, here is what I do for you. I call you into relationship with me. I will make you a part of a great nation. All these things God gives to us. And the greatest thing that God gives to us is God gives to us himself. God gives Jesus. God gives righteousness. God gives forgiveness. He gives blessing. He gives new life. God gives all of these things for you. It continues. And I will give to you and to your offspring after you the land of your sojournings, all the land of Canaan, for an everlasting possession, and I will be their God. So we said we're going to get lineage, and we're going to get land, and we're going to get the Lord in an everlasting kind of way. And your spiritual descendants will receive these things as well. And you and I, Christian, we are the spiritual descendants of Abraham, because Father Abraham had many sons. Many sons had Father Abraham, right? I am one of them, and so are you, right? So we praise the Lord. Good song, good theology. I dig it. Let's keep going, verse 9. And God said to Abraham, as for you, you shall keep my covenant, you and your offspring after you, throughout their generations. So he says, Abram, you're going to have sons, and you're going to have grandsons, and they're going to walk with me. But here's the other side of that, right? That if you don't walk with me, then they will make a mess of their lives. And we get this generational talk often in the book of Genesis, and it's important for us to recognize this as well, because sometimes you read that and say, well, wait a minute. Is God saying that if Abraham does something wrong, then his kids are going to be punished for it? That sounds awful capricious. That doesn't sound fair at all. And I would say to you that that's not what God is saying. God is just kind of telling you what happens. See, because if dad's not a believer and dad doesn't teach the faith to the kids, then guess what? The kids aren't going to have faith, and the kids are going to walk away from the Lord, and the kids are going to suffer. It's not punishment, it's prophecy. That's just what happens. And so we do. We want God to bless. But sometimes we're not willing to obey. Right? You might say something like, well, I want to use the blessing of God. I want him to bless me. But then you're kind of saying this. I want God to bless me, and I want to use those blessings to do terrible things. Well, who's the bad guy in that equation? Right? No, so God calls Abraham, I want you to be in a relationship with me, and in you knowing me, then your sons and your grandsons will know me, and I will bless them. That's what happens. Abraham, I want you to not just raise a son, I want you to raise a believer. This is the calling that he places upon him. This is what this generational language means when we hear it, particularly in the Old Testament. That God is not just going to give him real estate. He's not just going to give him a nation of people, but a nation of people who love and know him. And so he continues and tells him more about this particular covenant. And we'll talk about some of that another time, but I do want to skip down and get to the story of Abraham's wife. So verse 15. And God said to Abraham, as for Sarai, your wife, you shall not call her name Sarai, but Sarah shall be her name. And now, so it's always important, particularly in the Old Testament, when we get a name, we want to know the definition. We want to know what it means, because names are very important in the Bible. And I would tell you that those of you who are parents, soon to be parents, aspiring parents, names are very important, right? Because you want to give your child a name that is a legacy that they can grow into, right? So we get this first name, Sarai, and our kind of guess on this, it means princess or contentious, one of those two. I'm not going to say anything. I'll just keep going. And then the second spelling, Sarah, that is widely known, that, you know, the definition of the word Sarah is princess. And if you keep reading the book of Genesis, you'll find out that she's kind of a diva. So that's another time, though. So this is her name. And it makes sense, right? If Abraham's going to be the father of many nations, it makes sense that a princess will bear those children as well. Verse 16. And I will bless her. And moreover, I will give you a son by her. I will bless her, and she shall become nations. Kings of peoples shall come from her. Now, it's been difficult so far in this relationship. They've been waiting a long time to have a son, but here God is with them, and they've even done some shady things to try to make that happen on their own. Sarah, in fact, gave his handmaid to Abraham to try to have a son that way. That's a whole different story. Here's the important part. God forgives their sin, and God gives promise. And ultimately, this promise is going to lead to the birth of Jesus. Right? From this contentious, disbelieving woman. And from this, Abraham's got his own issues as well. He's got problems. This is how good God is. It's a reminder of how bad we are, but how good God is, that he brings blessing and he gives covenant even to people like this, even to people like you and me. We'll keep reading, verse 17. Then Abraham fell on his face and laughed and said to himself, shall a child be born to a man who is 100 years old? Shall Sarah, who is 90 years old, bear a child? And I like the way Abraham kind of cuts this up here. He's like, God, I'm old, but like, Sarah, really? But God says, yes, this is going to be my gift to you. 18, and Abraham said to God, oh, that Ishmael might live before you. God says, no, but Sarah, your wife, shall bear you a son, and you shall call his name Isaac. The name Isaac means laughter. I will establish my covenant with him as an everlasting covenant for his offspring after him. The same kind of this language that's there. And Ishmael was the son that they had and that I described a little bit earlier. That was not the son of promise that God went forward with. God says instead, I will give you a son and his name will be Isaac, and many nations will come from him, and the promise that I've made to Abraham will continue through Isaac. I will establish my covenant with Isaac, whom Sarah shall bear to you at this time next year. And it says, when he had finished talking with him, God went up from Abraham, and the story goes on, and God continues to work in his people, in the hearts of his people. And in just a few chapters, Abraham's going to get his son. And him and Sarah, they will rejoice. I can tell you this. God called Abraham out of obscurity. And in fact, in Genesis chapter 13 or 12, whatever it is, 12, when God first speaks to Abram, Abram's probably not even a believer. But God calls him to be in relationship with him. God calls you, God calls me to be in relationship with him as well. So as we finish this story and as God leaves Abraham and Sarah with this promise, they wait. And they wait to receive their child of promise. And in that child's life, he'll have the incident that we discussed last week, Abraham bringing Isaac to the mountain, commanded by God to sacrifice that which is the most dear to him. And yet, God spares Isaac. God grants grace. And just as Abraham and Sarah will receive their child of promise, we receive a child of promise as well, and his name is Jesus. Now, in this time, as we're in the season of Lent, though, we await his sacrifice. Right? We anticipate Good Friday and Golgotha. And as we do so, we have this period of time that is a time of repentance. It is a time of contemplation. It's a time where we consider our sinfulness, a time when we repent. In a lot of ways, it's kind of a time of darkness, isn't it? We change our hymns. We sing hymns. More of the hymns we sing are in minor keys. Sounds kind of dark, doesn't it, during the period and season of Lent. So we await that sacrifice, and ultimately we await his victory. We await Easter morning. We await that time when Jesus conquers sin, Satan, death, and hell, and does so in our place for our sins. And so, we await that sacrifice. We await his victory, and ultimately, in the here and now, we await his return. Because the child of promise is coming back, and there will be a return of the King. So prepare your hearts, receive his gifts, know his covenant, and know that he loves you. In Jesus' good name, amen. We continue with the creed and the prayers. Please stand. And we confess our faith in the words of the Nicene Creed. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all worlds, God of God, Light of light, very God of very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary and was made man and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried, and the third day he rose again according to the Scriptures and ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of the Father. And he will come again with glory to judge both the living and the dead, whose kingdom will have no end. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets. And I believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Let us pray for the church here and around the world and for all people in their various circumstances. For the church around the world, all people who join Peter in professing that Jesus is the Christ, that they trust God's purpose for their lives, take up their crosses and follow, let us pray to the Lord. For all who spend their lives serving the physical, mental, social, and emotional needs of the people around them, that God bless and guide them according to his gracious purpose, let us pray to the Lord. For professional counselors and private confidants who alleviate sufferings, enable endurance, support character, and encourage hope, that they serve as conduits for God's purposes in the lives of their patients, family, and friends, let us pray to the Lord. For those who lead the governments of the world, that they find purpose in their positions, using every means to increase harvests, combat global health crises, minimize conflict between nations, and ensure equal justice for all their citizens, let us pray to the Lord. For those near and dear to us in need of prayer, Lord, we pray for Ida Trojak and her family, on the death of her son, Alan. We pray for Mary Audix, who has surgery tomorrow in Houston. We pray for Pam Withrow with recent surgery, for Caleb Brown, who is under doctor's treatment. We pray for Sherry, who is hospitalized. We pray for Mary Helen Golke, for Bill Haley, for Paula Joe, for Craig Trammell, and also for Sarah Kieschnick. We ask, Lord, that you would bring about the healing, comfort, freedom, and dignity for which they send requests to our gracious God. Let us pray to the Lord. Heavenly Father, we ask that you would be with our world as well as we struggle with pandemic. Lord, be with leaders. Give them wisdom. Lord, teach us all to look to one another for strength and for hope. Lord, teach us all to trust in you. For all of this, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. These and any other things you would have us ask of you, Heavenly Father, grant to us for the sake of the bitter sufferings and death of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, in whose name we pray. Amen. And hear us, Lord, as we pray the prayer that you've given us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Now receive the benediction of the Lord. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you his peace. Amen.